Are you glad to be back in church?
Amen.
Wow. I've been telling Pastor John for a few weeks, we're going to have a celebration when we get back. Y'all want to do that this morning? I think that's the thing to do. Stand with us. Turn to hymn 353 and let's sing about this victory in Jesus together. Sing it out.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about His groaning and His precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and now my love is to Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion He has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory.
Sing it out, church.
Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and now my love is to Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
If you got something to celebrate, say amen. 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 Be seated, please. Again, I want to just welcome you here. It's so good to be back in the house. Do we have any visitors in the house, first-time visitors, or folks who maybe never been recognized? Good to see you here today. I'm thinking there's going to be a lot of people there tomorrow because our people are faithful. And I'm kind of blown away, to be honest with you, the people that are here, and I'm thankful that you're here. Nothing against the people that stayed home. If you don't feel comfortable coming or if you're at risk, please stay home. That's where we want you to be. And you can worship right on your computer like we've been doing for 3 months now. But if you're able to come and not at risk, come on in and we'll continue worshiping as we go. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's continue our singing this morning, if you would. Turn to hymn 740 and let's sing about this joy unspeakable that we have. Stand with us.
I have found His grace is all complete. He supplieth every need. While I sit and learn at Jesus' feet, I am free as free indeed. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, of the half has never yet been told. I found the joy no tongue can tell, how its waves of glory roll. It is like a great o'erflowing well, springing up within my soul. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. All the half has never yet been told. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. All the half has never yet been told.
Amen. Be seated, please.
It's so good to see you. I've missed you all so much. You know, I might get through this day without crying a little bit, but but you're my family. You're part of my family. And I've missed y'all. And like I've said so many times, you know, just me and Brother Jack in this room, I said he had to endure a lot of my jokes by himself. It's good to see some other faces in here too, and I know Brother Jack would agree, but faithfulness is so true in what Keith was just saying. Your faithfulness to this church, from the pastor's heart, I'm grateful. You know, your love for the Lord, you're given to this church, the ministry, he didn't stop, still going on. And your care one for another and calls that you've made, checking on people, and you know, that's what a church is about. That's the church, loving each other. And I'm glad to have you here and our guest here with us. It's good to see Scott here this morning. That's Todd's son, and we're glad you're here. And others that are with us today. And we've got a lot to be thankful about, don't we? I'll say a little more in my message this morning because I'm doing the second part titled Facing Our Giant. And we've been in a giant of times, haven't we? We face some giants. But God is victorious. Amen? And He's going to come out on top because He is in control. And so this morning I just want to share some prayer requests with you. We want to, of course, continue to remember the family of Bob Peterson and the loss of his brother, GF. You remember this family, and Beverly Womack has been having some concerns with chest pains, and they're running tests, but as far as I've heard, there's nothing that they've found out yet, so I'm hoping they have since the last time I heard, but pray for them. I pray that you, I know you're praying for Brother Bob, and I had a good visit with him last week, and he was pretty talkative that day. Didn't understand everything he said, and I know there's several others of you've been going to visit him. I will say this, and Ms. Gail, you made him some cookies. I said, them cookies were good now, weren't they, Brother Bob? He said, yep. He did say that. But before I left, he stood up, and he put his hand out to shake my hand. And I shook his hand and I said, I'm going to do one better. I want to give you a hug. And I hugged him. And you know what he said? That's nice. See, that thing is, we've been missing that, haven't we? The interaction, seeing people, hugging people, holding their hand. My mom, I got to hold her hand for the first time this weekend. And I had, first time I couldn't see her, I'd see her through a window and wave at her. But when I left, she said, son, before you go, she put her hand out. She said, would you pray with me? I said, sure, Mom. I didn't hardly make it through that prayer, but I prayed for her. And see, that's what we miss is those hugs and that touch. Something about that touch. But we're going to get through this. We are. I appreciate the prayers for Gay, and she's now lost all of her hair, and that's why I've cut short a little bit to support her. It was actually shorter than this 2 weeks ago. I was about completely bald, but that's okay. My father-in-law would always say, you know, God only made a few perfect heads, and on the rest he put hair. There you go. Amen. Some of you gentlemen can concur. But let me share a few other requests with you. Suki Stevens has been having a lot of health concerns. She's had some bad falls, and y'all pray for her and her recovery. And Robert Black's been going through some really, really hard times health-wise. And pray for Robert. And Martha Matthews continuing to lift her up in prayers and the travels. And I went to do a funeral. When I came back through Atlanta yesterday, a really good friend of mine, I call him Daddy Mo. He's like a second father to me. But I did his service yesterday. There was only about eight of us gathered at the graveside. But Daddy Mo, I did Mama Shelley's funeral some years ago, but it was just the eight of us there, and we had a good celebration of his life there at the graveside. So, and there's so many others that need prayer, and if you have prayer needs upon your heart or someone you're here lifting up, would you just lift your hands to the Lord? Amen. A lot of hands around here. And if you're glad to be here this morning, would you just say a hearty amen? Yeah, it's good. Let's pray. Father God, it is so good to be in your house today. Just to be with brothers and sisters in Christ, it's family that's here today. And Lord, it's a celebration time. Whenever we come into the house of the Lord, even just because of what we've been through these last 3 months, but every time we come in the house of the Lord, it's a celebration of you, Lord. It's not about us. It's not about anything we've done. But Lord, it's about all that you've done. Because you're a mighty, mighty, gracious, loving, merciful God. Where would we be without you? We'd be in a mess of trouble, that's for sure. Lord, I lift our country up to you. Our country needs to turn their eyes towards you. There's a lot of things that have been going on in this world. Not all good. But at the same time, I've seen a lot of good come out of the bad. I've seen people doing things for other people, reaching out to other people, making a difference in other people's lives. And that's what we're called here to do. As brothers and sisters in Christ, we're called to make a difference in a world that needs to see a difference. And that difference is Jesus. So Lord, I pray that if nothing else comes out of this, Lord, that we start thinking about others, not ourselves, but other people. We all have needs today. We all have hurts. We all have concerns. We have people that, I know some that have lost loved ones during this 3 month period of this coronavirus that we've been in. It's been difficult, but Lord, you've seen us through it so far, and you will see us through it continually. Father, I lift all these requests up to you, the requests that we've mentioned, the requests of the show of hands. Lord, you know each and every need that's in this room today. And Lord, we thank you ahead of time in advance for what you're going to do. We love you, Lord. We praise you. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Amen.
Now, Pastor, in his prayer there, he just said, seen a lot of good come during this bad. And that's the truth. People step up, don't they? People who love others step up. And I've seen it so much, and you've seen it in the news, talking about the churches are closed. I don't know about y'all, but my church hasn't been closed. They say that, and you wonder what they really know about the church. But you know, the church is not those concrete blocks and this carpet and the wood that these pews are made of. Oh no, but y'all know that, don't you? The church is alive and well. It was alive and well right here in each and every believer with Jesus Christ. You believe that this morning? And I think the church, and when I say the church, I'm just not talking about Pineview. I'm talking about the church, all the children of Jesus. I think we proved that in the last 3 months, did we not? I don't know about y'all, but my Sunday mornings went something like this. Got up after making the coffee. I'd sip coffee and come to Pineview. Then I'd end up at a church in Evans. And finally, I'd drive to Columbia, South Carolina, and go to First Baptist over there by 11 o'clock. I saw a lot of good messages while we were out. And I'll bet that a lot of you did too, didn't you? Not just here, but took the time to watch. And I was well fed by our pastor and others. And I'm so thankful again for the faithfulness of the people, for being the church without the concrete blocks and without the carpet, because we know Jesus resides in our heart, does he not? That's right. Our pastor in just a few minutes is going to preach. He's going to tell us about some battles and about how we need to depend on our God and how we should be desperate for our God. And this song we're about to sing, tells just that, leaning on the everlasting arms. We need to be leaning on Jesus. Would you stand with us and let's sing this all together. Let's continue the celebration this morning. Hymn 575. Sing it out.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near, leaning on the everlasting arms. Secure from all alarms, leaning on Jesus, leaning on Jesus, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Amen. Be seated, please. I think this song goes right along with the sermon this morning.
I know your word.
are true. You're bigger than what I see. It's you in exchange for me. Cause even the impossible is your reality. God, even the impossible is your reality. Jesus, I believe. Jesus, I believe. Help my unbelief, God. Jesus, I
Amen. His promises are true. We can depend on Him for everything. And well, I want to just start off this morning a little lighthearted, and I'm going to start off with a joke. There was a preacher who was preaching on the second coming of Christ. Some of y'all may have heard this before, because I probably have told it, but if you don't, just bear with me on it. I forget sometimes what jokes I tell. But anyway, preacher was preaching on the second coming of Christ, and he got really excited, and he said these three phrases. He said them he said the same phrase three times. And so he got real excited. The first time he said, "Behold, I cometh." And he got real excited again. He said it even louder, "Behold, I cometh." Talking about the second coming of Christ. The third time he got so excited, he said, "Behold, I cometh." And he fell off the platform and landed on a lady in the front pew. And the lady looked startled, and he looked at her and goes, "Ma'am, I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to. I got so excited about the second coming of Christ. I didn't mean to fall on you." She said, "Well, you gave me three warnings. I should have moved." God is good. All the time, God is good. Yes, He is. Last week, we started a series on Facing Our Giants. It's a book that I've been reading, and many of y'all know this. I'm a very big fan of Max Lucado. Love his writings. And a book was given to me, Facing Our Giants. And so during this time of the virus, God laid on my heart, and it's been a while since I've been doing writing. I've been using a lot of messages that I've preached over the years, but God has inspired me to write. And I believe these messages are going to be timely because we face giants. Giants. We've been facing giants right now in this world. This giant called coronavirus. A giant titled racial injustices. We face those. You've faced giants. We face giants of health concerns, battling health issues. But there's other giants in our life, and so I want to continue the message I started last week, the second part, Facing Our Giant. So go ahead and turn in your Bibles for Samuel chapter 17. We're going to just read verses 40 through 47. Last week I brought out 3 points, and I want to remind you of those 3 points, talking about battles. It says, when the world says we can't, God says we can. Here's the second one. When the world says wait, God says go. Go. And when the world says we're alone in our battles, God says, I am with you in your battles. Isn't that good to know that we're not alone? But today I want to bring out 3 points, and I want to share these before we hit the scripture, is this. Number one, prepare for your battle. Prepare. The second thing, know that our battle belongs to the Lord. And the third thing, know that in Christ, we are victorious. We are. So let's stand in honor of God's word this morning as we read from 1 Samuel 17, verses 40 through 47. Speaking of David here, it says, then he took his staff in his hand, and he chose for himself 5 smooth stones from the brook and put them in a shepherd's bag in a pouch which he had, and his sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. So the Philistine came and began drawing near to David, and the man who bore the shield went before him. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy, good-looking. So the Philistine said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field." Then David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with sword, with spear, and with javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defiled. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you, take your head from you. And this day I will give the carcasses of the camp of the Philistines to the birds of the air and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. Then all assembled shall know the Lord does not save with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's. He will give you into our hands." Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Father God, we do face battles. But Lord, we know that through you we are victorious. So Father, now I just pray as we open up your word, as we look at it today, you speak your words of truth to us. And may we not be hearers only, but doers of your word. Father, move me out of the way. Speak your words of truth through me today. And Lord, we thank you for this time in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Point number one. And if you are taking notes, I think they're on your bulletin this morning. But it says, we need to prepare for battle. Some while back when we were doing our series of questions, we had a series of questions that we asked. And one of the questions was, why did David choose five stones when it only took one to defeat Goliath? And we kind of looked at that. And some of y'all might not have been here when we answered that question. But I want to kind of bring it back out because it's applicable to this scripture today. Here's the key, is to think about this. David didn't know that it was going to take just one stone. God did. You know, and things, when we face our battles, God knows everything. God sees the big picture, doesn't he? We only see sometimes, as I think about a TV, you remember the old TVs that had the big screen, and over in the corner had what they call that smart window, you know, where you can actually view another scene or another show while the other show was going on. I don't know if you remember those TVs or not, but actually it was kind of confusing to me because it's hard enough keeping up with one show trying to see two shows. But anyway, you know, that little smart window over there, that's sometimes what we see. But God sees the big picture. God saw the big picture of what was about to happen and what David was about to do. And see, David, as we're going to see here, put his trust totally in God. And that's what we got to do when we go to battle. We got to know that there's a bigger God. There's a God who's in control. All of this stuff has been going on with this virus and everything in this world right now. God is in control of all that. Amen? He is. A lot of times we forget that. But he chose those five stones. So here's another question. Why smooth stones? And when I looked this up, I found out that he chose these smooth stones because they actually had a better trajectory. They would actually travel better through the air, and they made it more accurate to hit your target. That's why they were smooth. You know, and only a person who used a slingshot knew that. David did. Because every day he was used to getting up, getting his stones together, prepared. He was a marksman with that, okay? If you want to call him a marksman. Because he would fight off the bears and the lions and all the wild animals to keep them from attacking his sheep. So he knew every day he prepared. David knew that he was ready for battle because he had this routine day in and day out. Now, when I'm thinking about routine, I start thinking about our routine. It's very important that we have a routine. And what I'm talking about is staying in God's Word. Prayer. You know, Paul talked about this in Ephesians. He talked about putting on the full armor of God. And that's what he wants us to do, is when we come to battle, we put on that full armor of God, all the way from head, that helmet of salvation, all the way to the feet that are shod with the gospel of peace. But when we think about this, also that belt of truth. And when I think about that belt of truth, I think about the belt of the Word of God. That we need to be in His Word. Not just coming to church and hearing it, but being prepared and being in His Word. You know, during this time of the virus, I went to church and watched services in Highlands. My daughter goes to this church called the Church of the Highlands in Alabama. So we already had it up on our screen. I'd hit the live version, and Chris Hodges would come up or whatever, who was preaching that day. He has multiple preachers. Matter of fact, this church has grown to 30 campuses in the whole state of Alabama, and they have anywhere from 40 to 50,000 people in their church, if you count up all the campuses. Big church. They're doing a lot of things for the Lord, too, and I was hearing about those. But that's where I fed, you know. And I'd listen to these messages, and I wrote many of them down and took notes. And just like I was in church, just taking notes, you know, and soaking in. And you know, our girls, we'd all gather, and my wife would sit in our living room, and our living room became our sanctuary. And I remember many times just sitting in the chair, and there'd be something, either a song that was sung or some words that were said, and sometimes I just wept before the Lord. But you know, that's part of our routine when we say, and I hope that spending time in God's Word is not just a routine, but it's a must. Amen. That we have to, we need to. We need to spend time in God's Word. We need to focus on Him. So David had this routine, and he was ready for battle. He knew it. So we have to be the same way in our lives too. 1 John 5:4 says, "For whatever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith." Another verse that speaks so much to me is, "Greater is He who is in me than he that is in the world." But then when we look at this verse about the putting on the armor of God, Paul goes one step further, and he moves from this belt of truth and putting on the armor of God to verse 18, where he says, "We are to pray always." There's another verse that says, "Pray without ceasing." And I looked that word, "pray without ceasing," that ceasing. You know, and I tell you, when I was driving through Atlanta, and I drove back through Atlanta yesterday, as I was telling you, I stopped through and did a funeral service there in Atlanta. But you know how traffic's bad. And you can do a lot of praying driving on I-285. You just don't want to pray with your eyes closed. That's not smart. But I am praying as I'm driving through there, and, you know, and people are merging in. That's the worst part. And I had to go through Spaghetti Junction, as they call it. Oh, my. Spaghetti Junction is not fun. It's got all these high, you know, bridges. We have what I call mini Spaghetti Junction, or if you want to call it, you know, maybe Spaghetti-O Junction here in Augusta. But that spaghetti, I mean, there's like bridges going everywhere and cars coming in and merging, all these different, you know, it's a stressful area, let me just say, especially during traffic. And these cars going up real high above these bridges. But you do a lot of praying when you're out traveling. But you know, Paul said something key here in Philippians 4:6. He says that we are to be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. So staying in God's Word and prayer is key to being successful in our battles. You got to put on that full armor of God. You got to be ready. You got to be ready for battle. Who is our adversary? Who is it? Satan. And you know what? He's going to come after us. He has attacked so many times. He's been attacking our family. When things come in here, you know, God allows. Let me just say, God allows things to happen. Sometimes we get away from God. Sometimes we get so far away from God, and I see so many people that just kind of leave God. But let me just say this. God never moves. He stays right there in that path. Wherever we left God, that's where He's still standing. You know what? He's standing with His arms held open wide and says, "Come back to Me. Come back to Me." He's ready with open arms to receive you and welcome you back. You know, if you say, you know, if God moved, no, we moved. God's still there. God's still waiting. So that's important to remember that. He is always there for us. Here's point number two. We need to know that our battle belongs to the Lord. I want to read verses 45 and 46 again. It says, "Then David said to the Philistine, 'You come to me with a sword, with spear, and with javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts of God, the armies of Israel, whom you have defiled. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you and take your head from you, and this day I will give the carcasses of the camp of the Philistines to the birds of the air, the wild beasts to the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel.'" David knew who his God was. He knew. He had a personal relationship. And that's very important to know, is that, you know, a lot of people have a head knowledge about God in this world. They have just facts. They have it here, but they've never moved from here to there. They've never accepted Christ into their heart. And when I say that, accepting Christ in the heart, I mean they're floating around in our blood-pumping muscle. But He's in our inner being. He's in our soul. He's in our hearts. He's our inner being. He's there, that Spirit that comes in and dwells inside of us. And because of that, we have a change. Because of that Spirit indwelling in us, there's a desire not just to live for our life anymore, but to make a difference in a world, as I said in my prayer earlier, to make a difference in a world that needs to see a difference, and that difference is Jesus. And see, the thing is that David said something very profound. If you go to that last verse, in this last section, he says, "Then all the assembly shall know that the Lord does not save with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and He will give you into my hand." But that battle is the Lord's. I've had to learn to do that a lot during this time. Say, "God, I give you my battle. I give you my battle." Max Lucado's book, Facing Our Giants, I want to read a couple of quotes to you. He says, "In the battle, no one discusses God, but David discusses no one else but God. David sees what others refuse to see, but David majors on one thing. He majors on God." David does see the giant, mind you, but he sees God more. Are you hearing this, folks? We've been looking at this giant called coronavirus, and a lot of us have been focusing on it. We've been seeing the numbers, and the numbers well over 110,000 now that have died in this nation. And we see it, and we see them come across our screen, and we've seen all the hatred and the different things that are on the TV screen, all the rioting and all this. So it's been a lot of giants. There's been a lot of stuff going on. But there's good things that have been happening. You know, I told my daughters, they were a little bit bummed out because they had to come back from college. They wanted to finish up their year, and understandably so. Their friends are there at Georgia Tech and at the University of Alabama. And they come back and, you know, and I said, "You know what? There's something really good." And I pulled my daughters together. I said, "There's something really good out of this." And they looked at me real fast. They said, "Well, why? How is that, Dad?" I says, "You're home." And you know what? You're home in a time where your mom needs you. And they just stopped for a minute. And you could see the wheels turning. And they didn't say it because they never admit too much when dad's right. Daughters don't do that. Yeah. But in a way, you could almost see it saying, "You're right." See, it happened. God bringing something good out of something bad. And I think each and every one of us can see that in our own lives. We can see that God is bringing good through the bad. People doing other things. Some of you that have been making masks and, you know, doing other things, making phone calls, reaching out to people, continuing doing what you're doing. Like I said, the ministry didn't stop. The church didn't, you know, maybe the doors of the sanctuary may have been closed, but the church wasn't closed. The church goes on. Why? Because that's what the church does. Because that's who we are, as the body of Christ. Amen? Amen. Many times we look at it this way. Many times we look at the giants of addiction. We see the giants of financial troubles. We see the giants of sickness. But we forget this one truth. The battle is the Lord's. So what does this mean? We need to turn our battle over to the Lord. 1 Peter 5, 7 says this, cast your cares upon Him because He cares for you. If you're writing notes, write this down. When we say the battle is the Lord's, we're saying three things. We're saying this, I am not alone in my battle. I am trusting God in my battle. And I'm going to let God fight for me in my battle. That's the third thing. We know that we're not alone. Many of us, we know that. Jesus is with us. And a lot of us say, well, I'm trusting God in my battle. But here's the hardest part is this, is I'm going to let God fight for me in my battle. A lot of times we try to fight that battle on our own. And God says, turn it over to me. Give it to me. Let me have it. Let me have that. He faced everything. When Jesus went on the cross and he had his hands all stretched out, He says, I love you this much. And He stretched His arms out and He died for us on that cross at Calvary. He loves you. He knows everything that you're going through. I believe every pain, every struggle, every sin, every difficulty in this world was on Jesus when He hung on that cross. He saw everything. Did He see coronavirus? I bet He did. Did He see struggles in this world? Did He see hatred? Did He see anger? Did He see sin? All the sin? Yes. That's why God had to turn His head away and He said, my God, why hast Thou forsaken me? That was the most loneliest time in Jesus' life. When God had to turn His head away, He couldn't even look at His Son as He took on the sins and the troubles and the trials and all the battles of the world on Himself. Because He loves you. Greater love hath no man than this, that one would lay down his life for a friend. That is the greatest sacrifice. Because He loves you. I was turning on the TV. This is when the epidemic was pretty severe. And I tuned in on a news special. And they were interviewing nurses that were on the front lines. We know they're heroes. They are. They're heroes. And I remember the testimony of this one nurse. He said there was a 35-year-old family man that was in the room. And this nurse telling the story couldn't even get through the story without tearing up. And he said, I sat by his bed, family not being able to be in the room with him. He was struggling for breath, for air. And this is what he said. He said, I sat by his bed and tried to console him, tell him that his family loved him, and said this, I know that you're a good father. I know that you're a good husband. But then he closed what he said. He said, that person, that 35-year-old family man didn't make it. And he looked into the camera of that reporter and he said this, but the hardest thing of all of this is seeing people die alone. And you know he's right. Alone in one way, alone because the family was not able to be there. But we know this, is that we're not alone. Even if we're alone and nobody else is around us, Jesus is there. Jesus is with us. And yes, we hunger for that physical touch. You know, like I said, that first time when my mom was in the room and I couldn't see her and I just was standing at the window telling her, Mom, it's going to be okay. But this time I was able to hold her hand and to pray with her. That makes all the difference in the world. You being here today and being able to see each other, this is great. I pray, folks, that we never take this for granted. You know, that's what I heard a lot of people say. You know, I took church attendance for granted. I could just go. But you know what we learned through this? This all from, and it has been in some ways. Now, let me just say this. Deep down, did I really want to stop services? No. No. Pastor's heart is no, but I felt like to be obedient. You know, the state and those leaders higher up said, no, don't do this. And we saw some repercussions of what happened when they did. Some churches ended up getting infected. And I know one pastor down near where I live has got his congregation infected. They were meeting and the pastor died. And some others, I think some of the members passed too. You see, I as a pastor, this is something unprecedented. This is something that's hard because it was a tough decision to make. It wasn't easy. I prayed about it. But also I said, well, I'm the shepherd, and I didn't want to put you in jeopardy. That's why. But I started to see some wonderful things happen. I started seeing some people stepping up to the plate, and some of you are calling me or telling me some of the things that you're doing and making calls and visits and making the mask and doing other things. And even during this time, some of the ladies are making these beautiful dresses that are going to go out to third world country children, using this time productively. See, nothing happens by coincidence. There's reasons. God's trying to get our attention. God says, I'm trying to get your attention. Are you listening? That's the thing. Are we listening? In the midst of our battles, God is teaching us lessons. Are we listening? Which leads me to my third point. It says that we know in Christ that we are victorious. I want to share the last part of this. It says, so when the Philistine arose and came and drew near to meet David, and David hurried and ran towards the army to meet the Philistine. Then David put his hand in his bag and took out a stone, and he slung it and struck the Philistine in his forehead, so that the stone sank into his forehead and he fell on his face to the earth. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone and struck the Philistine and killed him. But there was no sword in the hand of David. Therefore David ran and stood over the Philistine toward his sword and drew it out of his sheath and killed him and cut off his head with it. And when the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they fled. You know, when I looked at the first part of this passage, I see an important truth here. It did say that David rushed towards his enemy. He could have ran. All the others did. I don't want to fight this Philistine. He's big. He's tall. He's mean. But here was a youth, David, that hurried. He rushed towards the enemy. In Max Lucado's book, he wrote this. Max wrote this. He says, when was the last time you rushed towards your enemy? How long has it been since you rushed towards your giant? As we rush our giant, let us try this tactic, a different tactic. Let us rush our giant with a God-saturated soul. A God-saturated soul says this, God is in control. A God-saturated soul says, divorce, you will not enter my home. Addictions, you will not destroy me. Sickness, you will not defeat me. And because of this, my victory is in the Lord. And we see that David was victorious. Yes, it took one stone to defeat the giant. David slung the stone, but God got the victory. And what do? When God gives you the victory, give Him the praise. He deserves it. Amen. Let's give a praise clap to the Lord. Amen. He is victorious. Yes. David knew that it was God that gave him the victory. And we will have this victory too. You know, we pray for people to get well. And we pray for that physical healing. But we know if the physical healing doesn't come, God brings that ultimate healing. And that's when we're free. And that's when we're free. And that's when we're in His presence forever and ever. So as I close out today, I just want to share this with you. You know, as we think about the message today, three things. No, number one, I'm not alone in my battle. As we know the promise, He'll never leave us nor forsake us. The second thing is I'm trusting God in my battle. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. And here's the third thing. I know that in Christ I am victorious. I can do all things through Christ who gives me what? Strength. In the closing of that chapter, Max wrote this. And this is an interesting quote. He says, "Focus on your giants and you're going to stumble. Focus on God and your giants will stumble." Let me say that again. Focus on your giants and you will stumble. But focus on God and your giants will stumble. I want us to say this together this morning. You know, when I was putting these messages together, I realized one thing. There was a time when I was really down. My mom wasn't getting better. Gay was struggling and is struggling with her treatments. And I went back over these notes and I said, "God, these messages are not just for the church. But God, these messages are me." Folks, when I'm preaching these messages, I'm preaching to myself too. I have weaknesses. I struggle. I have difficulties. I have battles just like you. But the thing is we're in it together. But we're in it together with the Lord. And that makes all the difference in the world. So what I want us to say is this today. And I want us to say it out loud together. And I want us to believe this. It's a very short little sentence. And I'm going to say it and then you say it after me. God, my battle is yours. God, fight this battle for me. God, my battle is yours. God, fight this battle for me. I want you to bow your heads with me right now. Right now, in the stillness of this moment, I want you to think of that battle that you're facing right now. Whatever it is, addiction, maybe it's an emotional thing. It could be your past. It could be sin in your life. Whatever that battle, sickness. Maybe you're not going through a battle, but you know somebody in your family that is. I want you just to pray right now. Say, "God, my battle's yours." Tell them that right now. You know, maybe you're here this morning and the Lord has spoken to your heart. You said, "You know, there's never been a time in my life where I've asked Jesus to come in and be my Savior." You know, you're not going to be able to overcome your battles unless Jesus is in your heart and battling for you. So the most important step right now is to say yes to Jesus. And it's not, I want to have a prayer just now. And if you're here this morning, maybe you've never asked Jesus to come in and save you. But you say yes to Jesus today. I want to give you that opportunity. What does that mean when you say yes to Jesus? When you ask Jesus into your heart, you're saying, "Jesus, I'm a sinner. And I've messed up. But Lord, I know that you went to that cross at Calvary. That you died on that cross for me." Cry out to Jesus. Say, "Jesus, save me. I need you, Jesus. I need you to come into my heart." Tell him right now. Tell him, "Jesus, I need you in my heart right now." And tell him this, "Lord, I want you to be not only Savior of my life, but I want you to take charge of my life. I give my life to you, Jesus." Tell him. And with all heads bowed and eyes closed, what I want to do right now is I just want to look up. And if you prayed that prayer of salvation this morning, you know what? It says that the angels in heaven rejoice that you are a believer, that you belong to Jesus, and that one day you're going to heaven. It's the belief. It's the trust that you've put in Jesus. And if that's you this morning, what I want to do is I'm just going to look around. No one else looking around right now, but if But if that's you, I just want you just to slip your hand up where you are. If you prayed that prayer this morning, would you just raise your hand? Amen. Anyone else? Amen. But here's the second part of this invitation this morning. And you're here and you say, you know, I have been going through some battles. I have been going through some struggles, but I haven't really been turning them over to Jesus, but I want to do that. And that's a step of faith. Trusting Him with all your heart and leaning not on your own understanding, but giving it over to the Lord. But you're acknowledging by raising your hand here in just a moment, says, you know, I'm struggling. I'm going through some battles. But I know that God is with me, and God is going to help me come out of this victoriously. I know He will. Would you just lift your hand where you are? You're going through some battles, some struggles. Amen. That's right. Amen. Let's pray together. Father God, I just thank You for this time. And Lord, I know even in this invitation it's going to be a little different because getting up and coming forward, not able to do that. But what I'm going to ask, if you've made a decision this morning, is when the service is over, I want you to come forward and talk to me, share your decision with me. So if you'll do that, if you've made any kind of decision, a rededication, or you've given your heart to Jesus, I just want you to come down after we sing this song, after we close out this service, and tell me of the decision that you've made today. And we'll go from there. Father God, I just give this invitation song to You. And Lord, may we take the words that we've heard today and apply them to our heart and go out rejoicing, because the battle is won through You. In Jesus' name, amen.
I need Thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like Thine can peace afford. I need Thee, oh, I need Thee. Every hour I need Thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to Thee.
As we exit today, and we're going to have a prayer first, and I'm going to ask Aubrey if he'll lead us in that prayer. But if you've made a decision today, come talk to me. Just, you know, wait, come on down the aisle and let's talk at a safe distance if you made any kind of decision. I want to know that, okay? Aubrey?